Friends, today's NRI Summer program from Los Angeles brought to you commercial free by listeners like you. Your generous donations make possible for us to stay commercial free. And today's show is pre-recorded. If you have a question for the guest, please send an email to nrisamay@gmail.com. We will follow up with the guest and find the answer for you. Thank you for your support.
Good morning. Good morning, good evening, and welcome to all our listeners on NRI Samay. Today we are going to talk about the border issues between Assam and Nagaland. And, very recently, if you remember, the northeastern states, Assam, Nagaland, were in the news, but unfortunately they were in the news for the wrong reasons. Today we have Amitstar's Bundita Acharya, who works for the Purva Bharati Educational Trust and has been very closely following these issues. So we'll talk to her about the history of these border issues, what led to this current issues that we have seen, and what is the way forward, and so on and so forth. So, Bundita, a very warm welcome to NRI Samay.
Yeah, hello. Yeah, hi.
So Bundita, before we get started, can you please let our listeners know what is your association with this educational trust and how you got to be involved in even connected with these border issues?
Yeah. Thank you very much. And this educational trust, is based in the Upper Assam, and we basically work on the issue of human rights, women rights, and also education and health. And also we are part of a network, women network. It is called Women in Governance. Basically, we work on the issue of women and security, women leadership, and also the customary law which is prevailing in the northeast part of India. And this is a national level network, and we have been documenting the cases of human rights and any conflicts happening in this part of India. And also we have been raising these issues in the at the national or international level, like in UN and all. And from the very beginning for this conflict, we have been following up this cases and how it has happened. And this is not the first time it's happening since 1963, when the Nagaland became the state. Earlier it was a part of Greater Assam state, but in 1963 they became an independent state. Since then there's always a conflict in these border areas of Assam and Nagaland, which is almost at a 437 kilometer long distance, which covers four districts like Jorhat, Dibsagar, Kabi Anglong, and Golaghat district. And this recent conflict is happening in the border of Assam and Nagaland in the Golaghat district. Recently, actually, on 28th and 30th, we had visited the border areas of this the conflict-affected areas of Assam and Nagaland. We visited Assam side, and also we visited the Nagaland side, and we met with the people, and also we went to the areas where this was happening. We went to the relief camps where the survivors are now staying in the relief camps. There's almost 15,000 people have been displaced in these recent conflicts from that area.
I see.
So actually this issue came up when we talked with the local people in the Assam side or in Nagaland side. We came to know there's a conflict between the two persons on a same plot of land. When you talk with the people in Assam, Assam side, they say that mostly these areas are populated by Adivasi communities. The Adivasi communities I have to mention here, who are those Adivasis? Like during the British time, and the people from Chhattisgarh, Jharkhand, Odisha, and West Bengal are bringing to Assam to work in the tea garden areas. And since then, they have been staying in this, they've been living in this part of India, like it's now more than 100 years. Earlier they used to work in the garden areas, so they were just like labor in the tea garden area, and now they have been shifted to the other places where they have their own lands and they've been staying there. When I talk with the people from Assam, and they have said like from 1964-65 they have been staying in these areas. Initially, that part of that area, I'm talking about this recent conflict area, that Gulaghat and Assam, that Gulaghat districts and the of the Assam, where there were 32 villages, and recent conflicts happened in the 12 villages. And in that area, this was just a jungle, and they have said that they cut the jungle and they prepared the land for the cultivation, and since then they have been doing the paddy cultivation in that area. And initially there was like, there's not a formal kind of agreement between the people from Nagaland and people from Assam to cultivate in that area, which is called as a DAB, Disputed Area Belt. When that Assam and Nagaland was divided, that Nagaland got the states, that in that time, this belt is called as a DAB, Disputed Area Belt. Mm-hmm. Where like it's a no man's land, like where that Nagaland and they cannot buy or sell land in that area. Like no one is the owner of that area. This is still, it is a disputed area, but people are staying in that area. People are doing cultivation.
I see.
Yeah. So sometimes it is just a mutual agreement between the people of both the states. When we meet with the people in Nagaland, they say that these people are the tenants of that land, because the owner is them, like they say, people from Nagaland. They said they are the owner of that land, and they're giving land to these people just to cultivate. And then when we asked about, do you have any agreement on this, that you are the owner and they are the tenants, they said at that time we didn't have that kind of formal agreement and all, but it is a verbal kind of agreement. So, and where, if they cultivate in that land, there will be like 50% will go to the, that product, 50% of the production will go to the owner and 50% will be the tenants. But when you talk with the people in Assam, they say no, they have been living in that area since 64-65, and they have cut the jungle and they are doing this. And initially they, people from Nagaland, because they don't do the plowing and all. So they come to the place and just ask, okay, can you give some rice to us? So like initially it started like that.
Mm-hmm.
Initially it was like 10 months of like rice and 20, and then it increases the quantity of rice. So and then they have fixed the tax, like they have to give that people from Assam said that Adivasi have to give this much of rice to them. There was some they did some fix on that. So that because the disputes are going on in that area for long, and when it outbreaks, then people come to know. Otherwise, these small kind of disputes are going on in there. But in
this case.
Yeah, in the April, actually, the dispute started between two persons. Saman Sema from Assam and some Lotha from Nagaland, they had a dispute. And they said, like, in 2000, they had an agreement. Like, Saman Sema from Assam and the, Mr. Lotha from Nagaland, they had an agreement that the 50% of the cultivation will give in to the Lotha. Initially, they gave till 2013, this was going on well, but in 2014, the Saman Sema had stopped giving that rice to the Mr. Lotha, and that's how the dispute started in the month of April. And there was a series of meetings after that. The border magistrate was involved in that meeting, and ADC, additional deputy commissioner, and district commissioner were involved in that meeting. And they have agreed. They agreed to the come to that 4-point agreement. Like this land that Saman Sema will cultivate in that land, but this Lotha can construct a house in that type. House in that area. And what I should mention here, in that disputed area belt, no one can construct a permanent structure in that area, like the concrete houses. It has to be test house and all that. It's a temporary house.
I see.
So that in that agreement, Mr. Lotha can construct a test house in that area, and this and the land will be given to the Mr. Saman Sama on land, and the produce will be given to Mr. Lotha. So there are 4 points in that agreement, but it was not followed. And by that time, two school-going children, it was happened in July 26th, two school-going children were kidnapped on that day, on the 10th of July. And that day, Mr. Lotha also came to construct a house in that area. So he, Saman Sama, he didn't allow him to construct because he, according to him, they say like there are two of my children are missing. Then how can we allow them? And they were suspecting that it was kidnapped by the people of the other side. Like the people from Nagaland have kidnapped it, and it happened in 26, and they registered the complaint on 31st of August, so after 5 days. So there were lots of questions going on that and why they have delayed to register the case. But on that day when it happened on 26th and 31st, they registered the case, and the local police and Nagaland police, also the CRPF, were searching the two boys. In the meantime, they head out the CRPF camp, which is in the middle of this that area. When all the people were there in the, like they were heroing the CRPF camp, in that time, according to the CRPF officer whom we met yesterday, he said just one, they heard the shot of one bullet, and then the houses were like burnt in that area, and then one by one the houses were being burnt in that area, and then police also started firing because they said they were outnumbered. They could not prevent the firing from the other side. They just did the blank firing and lathi charge. On that day, that is on 12th of August, one person was killed.
I see.
By that firing. And on that day, almost 15,000, that is the information given by the local authority or by the CRPF, the 15,000 people had been displaced from that area, and they had been shifted to the different relief camps.
So these 15,000 people were living in that disputed area base?
Yes, 15,000 people, they are living in this area, in that village. Yeah.
I see. And they belong did they belong to both Assam and Nagaland or just Assam?
No, they are all, mostly they are Adivasis and few Kacharis and few, the Boru Kacharis and other tribes in Assam and the few Nepalis and the Muslims. They are Adivasis. When we talk with the local administration and the CRPF, we came to know that no one from the Nagaland village have been affected in this. They were not displaced. But when we talk to the people in Nagaland, they have said that in 5 villages of Nagaland, where also their houses are also been burned, but it is not official, no official record on this. And there was different now dimensions are there, and people are talking in a very different way. And when we meet with the people and when we talk with them, and we came to know it started with this the dispute of these two men who has that owned that land, plot of land, and then it started that. But also from the media and also like people, so when we talk with the people in Nagaland, and they said like the involvement of some underground groups are also there. Like in the media report, they are saying that there is the involvement of the NSN United, and also from the Nagaland side, when you talk with the people, then we came to know the involvement of ANLA is also there. ANLA is Adivasi National Liberal Army. This is an underground group by the Adivasi. They are also involved in this. But there are different discussions are going on, but exactly it is difficult to say. But when we talk with the people from Nagaland, the Gamburas and all, but they said they will not allow these people to resettle in that area. They are very firm on their decision. And when we meet with the local administration in Golagha, they also said there is lots of discussions at present now going on. The commissioner level discussion was there yesterday, and to resettle these people. Now also there are more than 4,000 people are in the camp, and mostly they are women and children. When we went to the relief camps and we found the condition of the relief camps are not very good. There are like it's the one room where men, women, children, adolescent girls, boys are staying in the same room, and there's like you can say there's no ventilation in that room, and like a very congested room, and many of them are now have started suffering from cold, fever, and in a very unhygienic condition they have been staying, and we saw that. And also the food which was provided by government is not adequate, like they're just giving rice, dal, and potato. That is the relief supply from the government side. And also some baby food, but we didn't find that there is adequate baby food is given to the inmates there in the camp.
I see. So I think a couple of things that you mentioned. The whole dispute started because there was this land and the two people, from either side, had some informal agreement. Now, Nagaland was formed way back in 1960, but it had a history of border
1963.
And it had border issues all along with Assam, right? Can you tell what kind of issues were these? This is mostly related to this disputed area, or were there some things beyond that?
Friends, NRS Samay is a non-profit independent alternate media from Los Angeles, USA, which brings positive stories from grassroots activists from all corners of India and across the world. If you have any interesting episode you would like NRI Samay to cover, we will be happy to do so. NRI Samay would also like to encourage amateur journalists who have a flair for highlighting current events. You can be part of our citizen journalist team. You could cover an important event, interview victims of an atrocity, or document an inspirational story. The idea is to have a mix of experience throughout all parts of the world, preferably supported by an audio or a video clip of your story to be aired, which will be the curtain raiser. You can also submit your opinion articles on important topics to NRI Samay. We will be happy to put it on nrisamay.com in the opinion section. All your work will be credited only to you. And if you're interested, please send an email to nrisamay@gmail.com.
If you go to the history, Nagaland was part of Assam. When they are part of Assam, it is like Naga Hill District. So when this Nagaland was created, that boundary was not done it properly. So now the demand is, like you must have heard about the Greater Nagaland, but some of the Naga groups are claiming for the Greater Nagaland. They said like the some of the villages which were earlier belonged to Nagaland, the Naga Hill district are part of Assam and part of the other states, bordering states of Nagaland. When this Nagaland was created, some of the villages which were earlier part of the Naga Hills are still in Assam. Their claim is that all these villages should be part of the greater Nagaland. So that was the demand. If you see the map of Assam in the border side, this railway line is going from the Guwahati to Dibrugarh. And if you see the other part of the railway line, which is near to the border, like the four districts covered, like Jorhat, Gulaghat, Sadia, Amlong, and Sipsagar. So that part they are claiming is almost around the 437 kilometers. This land, piece of land, they are demanding that should be part of the greater Nagaland, what they have said. So that is the demand of that NSCN IM or that Naga socialist that group, that NSCN IM or NSCN, that now there is a trip action of NSCN group. So that is their demand on that. But you speak to the people in Nagaland, again, we should mention here that NSCN IM and all that those who were led by the Nagas from Manipur. But when you talk to the people from Nagaland, so they are okay with this. They said, like yesterday also we had a discussion on data, what the people from Nagaland thinks on that. They said no. We don't want any dispute with Assam, so we are okay. We don't want any land from Assam. So that is they have said like that. And today also when I read to the newspaper, local newspaper, it came like that. They are giving the statement that we don't want any land from Assam. So it is very difficult to say like whose involvement in this whole conflict. But at the border area, the time to time, these kinds of conflicts are taking place, and some are in a very large scale, and some like the small incidences like killing of one or two person are going on like it's quite regularly, which is not even coming into the local newspaper also.
I see. Now the current issue, right? Do you think that somewhere down the line this issue has been politicized? Because this could have also been one of those, you know, quote-unquote small issues between two individuals over a piece of land. And then it could have probably, you know, either be resolved or whatever it is, it was left to those two individuals. But the fact that it has engulfed into such a big issue with the police and border security force all coming, firing, and, you know, the whole issue has been, I think, beyond the individuals now.
Yeah. So, like, when we met with the local people and they said, like, it started, the dispute started in the month of April. And this incident happened in August. So, it seems from April till August that the local administration, even the CRPF, those who are there as a neutral force in that disputed area, they could have done something because they knew about that issue and they were involved into that. And when it started, according to them, they could have stopped it, but they didn't do much work on this, and that's how it happened into this large scale. And also it is worth mentioning here in this whole dispute, and when the protesters they did a road blockade, an economic blockade, and to disturb the that whole road was blocked, and that time police did the open firing. I think it has already been telecasted in the national level in India. So in that police firing, that as per the official report, four persons were being killed, and from the unofficial report, we came to know there is not four; it is the six person in being killed in the police firing. So police could have controlled this conflict, but instead of that, they fired on the people. They fired on the protesters. And when we asked the administration, and they have said, like, when the chief minister came to that area and the people threw stone to his car and all, and they were, using very bad language for the chief minister, and they were not allowing us to work, to move. And it is understandable. People have anger in their mind because police could have controlled that, but there was they didn't do that. And in front of them, their houses were being burnt and they could not do anything. So that it's quite obvious that people will have this anger. And instead of controlling that, the protest and all, police just did the open fire on that, and where there's, according to the unofficial report, that 6 people, young people, have been killed in that police firing. So, yes, there should be some political discussion on these issues to control the conflict, but that is not seen from the part of Nagaland government and part of Assam government, and also we could not see that kind of proactive steps taken by the central government.
I see.
Yeah.
I see. So what exactly is, how is the situation right now? Is the situation under control, and what is it like in these camps where all the people are living?
When we visited the area very recently, so like day before yesterday, and then yesterday we were in that area, and we still people are living in that camp, and some of the villages are still empty. And when we asked the security personnel, they said the situation is normal, but they were not allowing us to go to that area. And it looks like they're like terrorizing the people in that area. So we could not see that it is a normalcy has come, because we went to the villages. No one was there in the villages. We could see few men are there in the villages. They just came to see their houses, to see their cattle. Women and children are already in the camp. So, and when we talked to the people from Nagaland yesterday, and they very clearly said to us that they will not allow them to resettle in that area. So now that SSB and CRPF are deployed in that area, and in the remote area that SSB are deployed, but we could not see anything that government has taken a step to construct their houses. And we have come to know that government has declared the 50,000 compensation for the people to reconstruct their house. The people have said it is very less amount, that how can they reconstruct their house with the 50,000, which is very less amount. And that is that is declared by government. But we could not see any state government has taken so far to reconstruct their houses, and people are not there. And on 29th, when we are there in that area, that we came to know later on that people from Nagaland, they came and they have put their flag. They started construct house in that area. So we could not see that the proactive step taken by the Assam government or the Nagaland government to keep this the place in a peaceful way. People are still not going. And we saw the 2 schools are being occupied by army. The CRPF, they said it's a very temporary basis, but they need some places. And there some of the camps are still in the schools, and the children are not going to school, that they are in the camps, or where the camps are going on, and in that schools are closed now from 12th of August till today is the 31st of August. All schools have been closed, and we didn't see any alternative places where the government is trying to shift their camp. We didn't see that. So yeah, I feel that the way the government should respond to it, it is not responding in that way to that resettle these people. So it is obviously this question comes to the people, that to the people like us or to the common people, yes, because it is because they are Adivasis, that's why government is not taking that thing seriously or what that. So if this is the question now has come to the minds of the people or the human rights defenders, because mostly that Adivasis are targeted in this incident.
I see.
And even from the Nagaland side, it is very clearly they have said that they are the Adivasis. They said we don't have any issue with the Assamese people. So they have very clearly said we have a very good relation with the people from Assam, like the Assamese people. But these Adivasis have come from the Chhattisgarh and all, and they are not from this part of India. They are just a tenant. they have said like that. So this is a general question in the mind of the people, like, why this government is not taking a proactive step to resettle these people, and where will they resettle?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Now, do you also feel the fact that these issues do not get reported in the mainstream media, there's also very less pressure on the two governments on either side, and that could be one reason why there is reluctance politically?
See, like when these kind of incidents happened in the northeast part of India, and very late reports are reported in the mainstream media. So it is like we observe it in, on a quite regular basis, not in this incident, even that there are other conflicts also in the other parts of Assam, but they were not reported in the mainstream media. And we saw only the one report in that one national channel also, but that was also, we find that it is not a blaming the people for the entire state of Nagaland, but what we have seen that media, the way they have reported that that entire Nagaland people are involved into this incident, it is not like that. So yes, the blaming with each other cannot solve the problem. There should be a conducive environment to discuss on this issue of the border, which is not taking place. So blaming the people of Nagaland, blaming the people of Assam will not solve this problem.
Right.
There should be political will and political discussion on this issue. And these two governments should, that I think this is a lesson for these two governments to take a step and to have a discussion on this border issue, which has been going on for a long time in this area.
Right. I think you have beautifully summarized the situation. Unless there is a political will from either side, the border issues will continue to happen. And in the midst, as you said, the Adivasis are the people who are going to suffer. Hopefully, Bondita, you and organizations, other organizations or NGOs or other groups that are involved on the ground, you will be able to make your voice heard, and hopefully things can at least start on that direction, in that direction rather. Go ahead.
Yeah. Because I would also like to tell to the listener of this discussion, if people in the international community also should discuss and should know these issues happening in this part of India for a long, long, long time, but which is being not reported even that main India or mainstream media. And we appreciate that you are interested to know about what is happening in this part of India. And also I like to tell the listener of your show, this is not an isolated case. It has been going on for a long, long, long time. And border disputes is going on in this border, like in Assam Nagaland border or in the other international border, like Northeast is surrounded by the international border, like Bangladesh, Bhutan, the China and the Myanmar, and there is some border disputes are going on for long, and also the interstate disputes are going on with the neighboring states. And I feel that we should raise our voice, and the people should also know that what is going on this part of India. Yeah.
All right. So thank you very much, Bondita, for your time and sharing all the information about the current ongoing border issues. Hopefully, we'll stay in touch. And one last question.
Yes, definitely.
If anyone is interested in knowing what's going on the ground, is there any website where people can go and read about this on an ongoing basis?
I don't think so. There will be a website you can go what is going on the ongoing, but if you can go through this newspaper, I think they will get some idea, but that is also not sure that you will get the correct information on this, what is going on exactly on that area and that where this context is taking place.
Okay, all right.
But we will upload our information, our fact-finding report very soon into our website, and I would like to know when it is uploaded in our website, and we can go through this report, and we'll get the detailed information about this.
Okay, that'll be great. And what's your website again?
Yeah. Pardon?
What is your website address?
This is the website of the Wing Women in Government India. I will just let you know the name of the website. www.wing-india.org.
Okay.
We'll very soon upload their information into the website.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much for your time. So, listeners, that was Bhudita Acharya, who is closely following all the activities and the situation on the ground. And pretty soon, once the fact-finding report is available, the NRI summit team will also try and socialize that information. So this is your host, Suresh, signing off. Thank you very much for tuning in today. Thank you.
Friends, if you liked today's show, please go to youtube.com/NRI Samay and click on the subscribe button. You will get notified every time we publish a new show. And you can also like us on our social media sites like Facebook, Twitter, and Google+.